Okay. Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. And Stephanie Callaghan has sent her apologies this morning. Our first item of business is consideration of subordinate legislation, SSI 2023-142, the Education, Fees and Student Support Miscellaneous Amendment, Scotland Regulations 2023. These regulations, which are being considered under the negative procedure, will amend the Education Fees Scotland Regulations 2022 and the Student Support Scotland Regulations 2022 to include a new provision for individuals who have been granted a form of leave to enter or remain in the UK. The committee wrote to the Minister for Higher and Further Education and the Minister for Veterans for more information about the regulations and received a response. There were still some issues outstanding, so we welcome the Minister for Higher and Further Education and Minister for Veterans, Graham Day, to give evidence on this morning. And the Minister is joined by Nicola Nisbet, Head of Strategic Policy, Scottish Government, and Magdalene Boyd, of the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for your attendance, particularly in such short notice. We have agreed that the Minister will give an opening statement before we move to questions from the committee members. Minister, you have up to 3 minutes, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to address you today in regards to the amending regs before you. As I set out in my letter of 31st May, following a judicial review at the Court of Session last year, the Court declared that the long residence provisions within our education fees and student support regulations were unlawful. These provisions were originally brought in following a judicial review at the UK Supreme Court on the position in England, and with a view to providing opportunity for students who were not born in the UK nor had indefinite leave to remain, with an opportunity to access financial support when proceeding into further and higher education. Whilst the lengthy timescales associated with the long residence provisions drew criticism from the court, the position of offering full support to those who live in Scotland and regard it as their home and are therefore more likely to stay here after study and contribute to society is a sound one. At the conclusion of the judicial review proceedings, ministers committed to bringing forward amending regulations for the start of the 2023-24 academic year to ensure that students who had made Scotland their home or who resided in the country and wished to study in further or higher education had parity of access to support like their school peers. The Scottish Government launched a public consultation exercise on the proposals in January 2023, alongside undertaking stakeholder engagement, all of which helped shape the proposals before you today. The proposals expand the pool of students from a range of immigration statuses who can now be deemed as Scottish domiciled. It means for the purposes of being assessed for a home fee place with access to tuition fees and in some instances access to student bursaries and or loans, all students other than accepted groups must now meet the same length of residence in the UK, 3 years, to access this support. This sets all potential students who have a lawful basis for residing in the UK and wish to proceed to further and higher education on a level footing with their school peers in terms of time in the UK or Scotland, bar some noted exceptions. If these amending regulations were to be annulled, the substantive regulations would revert to our position pre-long residence. This would undoubtedly cause deep upset amongst many members of our communities who have made Scotland their home and wish to pursue further and higher education and would no longer be able to do so. Convener, I look forward to discussing this further, and I should say that I've brought my most two well-versed officials with me in order to assist these proceedings.
Thank you very much, Minister, and for your candid comments there. And can I now move to questions initially from Willie Rennie, please?
Thanks very much, Minister, for coming, especially at short notice. And we understand it's not a normal circumstance, so we appreciate your time. I mean, the legislative landscape is constantly changing, particularly with Brexit. Are we confident that this won't open the door to rest of the UK students being able to apply for these rights and opportunities in Scotland in the same way that this expanded group is entitled to?
Okay. I'll bring Magdalene in on that.
Yes, we are confident. The regulations still continue to require ordinary residence in Scotland. You have to have been in the UK for 3 years and currently ordinarily resident in Scotland. Now, that term has it's used in a wide range of case law, but in our regulations, we expand on the definition of ordinarily resident for the purposes of student support. And that includes a category clarifying the fact that if you are in Scotland just to access education, you're not considered to be ordinarily resident in Scotland. So that provision, which has always been in our regs, prevents forum shopping from the rest of the UK.
And you don't foresee any subsequent legal challenges that may open that opportunity? You don't. You're confident this is robust?
Yes, yeah. Scottish Government's confident just now, yes.
Yeah, OK. Sorry.
Stephen Kerr, supplementary on this?
Yeah, confident just now, you said. And I know that's probably legal speak for not setting anything concrete. I have concerns about how this will be interpreted because of the terminology of ordinarily resident. For example, in the SPICE briefing for today's session, it says the Scottish Government expects someone who is ordinary resident of Scotland to have made their home in Scotland with the intention of staying and living here. I feel that that is a huge open barn door, because how are we going to test expectations and intentions? So someone could move here, for example, at Easter and do a summer job, basically, through the spring into the summer, apply to go to a Scottish university, an address in Scotland, be able to prove that they're resident there, produce the necessary documentation, and then make an application. I mean, that's correct, isn't it?
Can I come in there? Yeah. Just to clarify, that's not something that's in these amending regs just now. That's something that has been in our student support legislation since the rest of the UK increased their tuition fees, these ordinary residence requirements.
It's not captured by these regs.
But in the... Yes, OK, so the message is not captured by the regs, but in the letter... the criteria that is given is ordinary resident in the UK for 3 years, ordinary resident in Scotland on the relevant date, which is the date of the commencement of the course, and granted a form of leave, etc. Which look, absolutely, one of our friends that have joined us in Scotland for various reasons, most notably the Ukrainians, to have access to higher education and further education, but you're saying that nothing will have changed in respect to people from the rest of the United Kingdom, whereas the way this reads, it sounds to me, as a non-lawyer, very important I make that point, that it sounds like there are ways to get around that.
Yes, no, there's nothing in our current amending regulations that change the position of access to Scottish universities or funding arrangements for students from the rest of the UK.
But so the case that I suggested, the scenario I suggested, that individual who has an address in Scotland, who's been here for a few months, they would not qualify?
No, they potentially would qualify, depending on the assessment by SAS, but that's always been the case. If SAS determined that they have made Scotland their home, even if it's only, it can be immediately, if that family have moved house from England prior to the relevant date, it is about ongoing intention.
I think what you're talking about is gaming the system.
Yes.
Yes. That's not going to happen.
That's not going to happen?
No, because we have the fallback of SAS as well.
All right. OK. Fine. I appreciate the Minister putting it on the record. And the reason that I'm labouring this point, I'm sure the Minister understands this, is the nature of the cap, the nature of the number of places and the financial commitment of the Scottish Government around those places.
OK.
And I'm obviously anxious that domicile Scots should be able to take up those places. I hope that's seen as a natural inclination that I would have as a Scot.
Thank you, Stephen Kerr. Can I move to questions now from Pam Duncan Clancy, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for coming along this morning. I want to reiterate my colleague Willie Rennie's thanks to you for that, because I know it is an unusual situation, and I do really appreciate you shifting things around and being here. This issue first kind of came to my attention when I think a colleague of mine, Paul Sweeney, who was then an MP, wrote to John Swinney in 2017 about a family that was really struggling to get access and wanted to contribute through this system. And so I understand, value and support the changes that are in the SSI. What my concern is that universities, I think, in the current circumstances that they're in, need to understand what this is going to mean for places and finance. So can I ask the Minister, how many people does he believe will be able to access home tuition fee rate and living costs as a result of the changes in the SSI?
So what additionality will the additional pressure, if you like? So we estimate the numbers to be somewhere between 36 and 76. And to put that in perspective, we're looking at somewhere between 0.03 and 0.06% of a pressure.
How have you come to the conclusion of those figures?
I'll bring Nicola into.
Yeah. So I think in the response from the 31st of May, we had set out where the parity was, which is the payment scheme that's running at the moment through SAS to support those students that have been impacted by the judicial review decision. At the moment, we've got under 80 students in each of the year cohorts 2020 and 2021 and 2021 to 2022 academic years. But we've also done some kind of manual looking at the amount of applications that came through since SAS opened for applications in April. And out of that, we've reckoned from the amount of applications that came through, there's about 0.03% that are of new students that wouldn't have been eligible previously. That's just based on the applications. And obviously, this is the first year that we'll be intending to run these new regulations. So that's what we can give just now as that percentage point over the 120,000 students that would access funding through HE. That's where the figures came from, that kind of that variance.
And are you confident that that won't increase as a result of the SSI?
Well, that's the numbers. The 20 numbers is using the kind of the parameters from the SSI.
Okay.
And the payment scheme was on the eligibility was in a very similar vein to the what's in the SSI now as well.
Can I ask, does that include the changes for postgraduate study?
The changes for postgraduate study is really a technical change. It's to do with students who wish to study in the rest of the UK. Before they had to have there couldn't be an equivalence in Scotland in order to do that, and that removes that requirement now. So it's not expected to be big numbers. Many of the students who were studying in England, Wales or Northern Ireland were choosing to go into postgraduate study, and if there was no equivalence, they were able to do that and be funded. The other change for postgraduate study is the tuition fee has increased as well for 23-24.
And on what basis do you think that it's a technical arrangement only? Because if there's about 11, my understanding is there's approximately 11,000 postgraduate student, undergraduate students, 5,000 go on to do postgraduates elsewhere in the UK. So that's a pretty big number. Do you know how many of those people will now be able to access free tuition as a result of the changes?
I don't know, but I can definitely take that back and report back.
Thank you. I also, just to put on the record, I think it's a really beneficial change. I can see that it would mean people could naturally follow on their course of education, but I think the numbers are quite big. Could you tell us again, Minister, is there going to be any additional funding associated with some of these changes for universities?
Given the numbers, no, not at this stage.
And is that something that you would look at doing in the future? If the numbers and how many would need to increase before you'd start to give universities more money?
It's impossible to answer that, but we're always reviewing how we provide support, and there are ongoing processes that will follow from this. So, of course, we'll continue to look at it. And clearly, if there was a very substantial increase, then that would have to be taken on board.
What would you consider to be a substantial increase?
I'm not going to be pinned down on a number. I think we can all work out what a substantial increase ballpark would look like. But we will. I give the assurance that we'll continue to look at this.
I appreciate that assurance and I welcome it, and I'd welcome the further correspondence on the numbers. But not given a particular number of what you consider to be substantial does present the question for universities who already we know that there's demand for capped places and that demand outstrips the supply. This could further increase that demand for good reason, as I set out when I started. But I think it's only fair that universities have an understanding about what the likely costs could be and what the implications for funding and cap places will be.
And I'm in no doubt they'll be seeking such an understanding, and we would provide that. That would only be reasonable.
Thank you. Appreciate that, Minister. Thanks.
Thank you. Can I also just clarify, and some of the terminology that was used by the member, Pam Duncan Clancy, there is, it's not free tuition for postgraduates, that it is, in fact, it's a loan. Can you just confirm that for the record, Nicola?
Tuition fee loan and living cost loan for the full-time postgraduate study. Students, those that are doing part-time, it's a tuition fee loan.
Yes, OK, thank you. Stephen, briefly.
Yeah, very briefly, Minister, in relation to tuition fees, are you willing to consider ideas that have been put forward by Sir Peter Matheson to allow domicile Scots the opportunity, if unable to obtain a place on a course at a Scottish institution?
You only need to answer this as briefly as you require, Mr Day, because the context of this is specifically on the SSI in front of us today.
Indeed, I would refer Mr Kerr to the answer I gave previously while sitting here a few weeks ago.
OK, thank you. Can we move to questions now from Bob Doris, please?
It's interesting, Minister, to talk about an answer you gave a few weeks ago, because I want us to go back to the future a little bit in relation to this. Convener, when I was first elected in 2007, a young constituent of mine from Sight Hill, originally from Mogadishu in Somalia, couldn't go to university because of rules and regulations at that time. I made representations to the then Cabinet Secretary for Education, Fiona Hislop, and regulation brought in place to allow young people from asylum-seeking families to go to university. This is something we've previously fixed and dealt with appropriately before. Unfortunately, through the passage of time, we've not kept the required legislation as attentive as it had to be to make sure that future generations of young people in the asylum process could get their right to an education. So my question is that these provisions will they be kept under review to make sure we don't find ourselves in that back to the future position again, where we previously, as a Scottish Government, did the right thing, certainly for my young constituent, who was the first asylum seeking under 18 to go to university in Scotland with a fully funded place.
Yeah. We were talking about this prior to coming into the committee today, about the need to ensure that all regulations that cover this sort of area are kept up to date as far as that's possible to do. So I think it would be very much our intention, accepting the pressures that exist on government in a variety of ways.
OK, that's helpful. So I said back to the future now, future-proofing, I suppose. So I have a constituent who was over 18 at the time where they arrived in Scotland, but they've been here for a heck of a long time, way beyond 3 years. They still have no decision on their case. They have no temporary leave to remain. They're keen to get a higher education place at City of Glasgow College. They will not be captured by these regulations, and I absolutely understand why. But at some point, of course, something has to give. Preferably the Home Office getting their decisions correct and speedily, to give my constituent the rights they deserve. But at what point will the Scottish Government return to look at these matters for adults who wish to be students, who are caught up in a system not from their making, to address these points? Will the Scottish Government look at that at some point for the benefit of my constituent?
Yes, we put it into a kind of future work plan, and it was put as part of the consultation analysis report that was published on the 12th of May of areas of work that were highlighted through the consultation and stakeholder engagement that would need to have further engagement, that Scottish Government officials would have to have further engagement on. And one of those is asylum seekers that have submitted a claim over the age of 18. So that is an area of work that we've recognised that there was issues raised through the engagement process.
So, convener,
briefly.
Well, I think it's relevant to the statute.
Yes, I get that, but I'm asking you to be more concise with your question.
So I thought it was given the appropriate context. So, my constituent, who I have got City of Glasgow College to accept that they would charge home student fees if they were able to uptake that place, has no right to funding from SAS. Is the government looking at any pot of cash that hugely challenging minister in the current times that may be accessible for students in that situation where the higher education institutions agreed to charge home student fees where they don't have to, but they're willing to allow my constituent and others to access higher education?
Yes, the guidance for the discretionary funds in further and higher education for both further and higher education have provision for support for asylum seekers who are facing financial hardship. So even if they're not SAS funded, there is a way that asylum seekers can access hardship support that comes through Scottish Government funding to the colleges and universities.
Right. Thank you. And final question. All relevant to the statutory instrument, convener?
I understand that. I'm just trying to meet your...
I know, but we are here to scrutinise the statutory instrument, convener. So there's another issue I've experienced, which is students who apply to university who have temporary leave to remain, but their overall future is uncertain, where universities in the past have been reluctant to accept them because they may not be able to give a guarantee that they can finish their course. That may be a thing of the past now, but is the Minister aware of that as having an issue previously, and should it be an issue?
It's not an issue I'm alive to, but please bear in mind I've been in post about 9 weeks.
Yeah. OK, thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Those responses. Do members have any further comments that they wish to make? This is where you would prompt any further action. I'm just making that clear now. Are we all OK? OK, thank you very much. So we'd like to thank you for your time this morning, and we will take a short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave. OK, thank you. On. Thank you very much. Welcome back. The committee must now decide whether it wishes to report on the negative instrument. So this is when I look for members to speak. Willie and then Pam.
I think we asked all the questions that we had concerns about, and I think we had as clear of assurances that you could expect from the Minister. I suspect this may come back again in another form at some point, but I think for now I'm satisfied.
And Pam Duncan-Clancy?
I too am satisfied. I appreciate the Minister's willingness to send information to the committee when he has it. So I think as long as we have a mechanism to make sure that is forthcoming, then I'm content.
And Stephen Kerr?
Yeah, I'm sorry, I completely agree with Willie Rennie. The Minister gave categoric assurances around things, but obviously we'll have to monitor the situation as it develops, because there are clear issues that may come back to us in due course.
Thank you. Bob Dorris?
Convener, I welcomed this instrument before I heard from the Minister. I got the assurances that were required from the Minister that it's a robust instrument. The only further assurance is one in the future, of course, that our committee will continue to monitor this and perhaps return to this in the next parliamentary session to see how successful it has been and how we have to improve it further.
OK, thank you very much. Anyone else wishing to comment? So, is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Agreed. OK. So, thank you. And that concludes our business in public this morning. And we will now move into private for our final agenda items.